Today we will discuss about the randomized complete block design, which is abbreviated by the RCBD. Okay, now think about when we need to compare the means of k populations in the presence of an extraneous variable. It means that now think about in the previous situation, what you had was you had just the several means, several treatments as T1, then T2 was there, likewise up to TK number of populations you had. Therefore, if you need to compare the means of this K number of populations, you have used the method called the completely randomized design or the CRD method. But now think about there is an external variable, what we are saying as the extraneous variable. If there is the existence of the extraneous variable, then we have to use the concept called the blocking. Therefore, for the complete randomized design, now we have to include the concept of blocking. Therefore, now what you have to do is, in the CRD, we just had the treatment, but in here, now there is another variable, what we are saying as an extraneous variable, and there are some blocks in the RCBD model, B1, B2, up to 4B. There will be several blocks. Okay. A block is a collection of k number of experimental units that are nearly alike as possible relative to the extraneous variable. Therefore, if you consider a single block, then each block contains this k number of treatments. Therefore, k number of experimental units are inside this block. And then each treatment randomly assigned to one unit within each block. Therefore, what you had done in the previously, in the CRD, you had a plot design, and then what you had done, then using a random number table, you have assigned the treatments. But now what you have to do is, now you have to select a single block. Then for this, inside this single block, you have to assign this k number of treatment. Therefore, if this is your block one, then you are assigning k number of treatments to this block. Then you may have another block called B2, and here also using a random number table or random number generator, you can assign the treatment. Therefore, in the randomized complete block design, you will get each treatment only once inside each block. Therefore, each treatment randomly assigned to one unit within each block. Therefore, each treatment appears once in each block. And now we will see about what is meant by these terms. The experimental design presented here is called as the complete block design, randomized complete block design. And this word block refers to the fact that experimental units have been matched relative to some extraneous variable. Means that based on an extraneous variable, we have identified the blocks. As an example, I have mentioned an example below. Before moving to that example, we will first of all go through these terms. Then the randomized refer that the treatments are randomly assigned within the block. Therefore, if you consider a single block, the treatments have assigned randomly. Therefore, in here, in the first block, you may have the first treatment. Then in here, you may have the third treatment. In here, you may have the second treatment, and in here you may have the fourth treatment within the first block. Now you have completed the first block, then you have to move for the second block. In here also, you are assigning the treatments in a random manner. Therefore, sometimes you may get treatment 4 here, then treatment 1 here, then treatment 3 will be here, then treatment 2 will be here. You can see each treatment appears once within the block, and treatments are assigned randomly. There is no any pattern. And then the next term is the complete. The complete implies that each treatment is used exactly once within each block. Therefore, this is how this term called randomized complete block design has been Complete randomized means treatments are assigned randomly inside the block, and complete means each treatment used exactly once within each block, and blocking refers to the experimental units have been matched relative to some extraneous variable. Okay, when we are considering this extraneous variable, what we have to keep in our mind is, for the experiment, we are considering this extraneous variable as the blocking, but we are not including for identifying any block effects in the randomized complete block design. And the next important thing is, we are assuming that the blocks and there is no interaction between the treatments and block. Those are the main assumptions. I will discuss about those things furthermore. Just for your knowledge, I have mentioned it. Now we will see an example for this randomized complete block design. Now think about an agriculture plot contains five varieties of tomatoes. Here now think about there are five varieties of tomatoes, and we need to test for four concentrations of vitamin. Therefore, for all these five varieties, vitamin have spread for each of these varieties. Therefore, all these varieties, they have spread the vitamin, but for this vitamin, they have considered four levels. Therefore, they are considering four concentrations. Therefore, four, five varieties were there, and four concentrations of vitamins were applied for each of these variety, and they need to check whether there is any effect towards the growth of the plant. Therefore, what they have done here is, here they have measured the height of these plants after some time after spraying these vitamins. And if we consider about this example, what we can see here is there are five varieties of tomatoes and there are four concentrations. But for our experiment, we do not need to get any idea regarding this. Are these five varieties are same or different? There is, we do not need to have an idea about those things. But what we need to know is whether there is any effect from the concentration of vitamin towards the growth of the plant. Therefore, this is an external variable. Therefore, variety could be considered as the external variable. Therefore, we can say variety would be the extraneous variable. Therefore, since variety is the extraneous variable, we will consider this variable for making the blocks. Therefore, we will consider variety as the blocks and the concentration level as the vitamins. Therefore, since the presence of the extraneous variable in this experiment, we can go for a randomized complete block design rather than using a complete block design. Therefore, plant varieties were considered as blocks and the concentration levels of vitamins were considered as the treatments. That is how we are identifying with what is the block and what is the treatment. Always the variable that we are interested for the analysis is considered as the, or the interested for the experiment is considered as the treatment, and the other variable would be considered as the blocking variable or the extraneous variable. Therefore, now if you see about the data layout of a randomized complete block design, you will get a data table like this. It is because now think about inside this block. Now think about inside this block. Now you can see there are K number of treatments. If you go for the second block in here also, you can see that there are K number of treatments. Likewise, now think about if you are having B number of blocks. If you are having B number of blocks here also, you can see there are K number of treatments. Therefore, now you are having B number of blocks and K number of treatments. And now you may think that if we assign the treatments in a random manner, how you have written these things in the as the ascending order of the numbers. It is like this. Now think about if you are having the blockings in this way, if this is your first block B1. Now you can see, if you consider the first block, there is an order as 1, 2, 3, likewise K. In the second order, second block also, you may have the same order 1, 2, 3, and 4. Therefore, what we have done here is, this is our first block. And we will think that there are only three treatments. Treatment 1 assigned here, treatment 3 randomly assigned here, treatment 2 randomly assigned here. Therefore, this is our first block. And this would be my next block, second block. For the second block, again, I will assign, here I am having third treatment, here I am having second treatment, here I am having first treatment. This is my second block. Therefore, now when I am writing these values, what I am doing is, first of all, I am preparing a table like this. Therefore, in the vertical manner, I am having my blocks B1 and B2. And in the vertical manner, I will have my treatments. Therefore, here I will have my treatment 1. Here I will have my treatment 2. And here I will have treatment 3. Without considering the random order, we are writing the treatments and blocks in the ordered manner. Now we have to consider the first block. In the first block, for the treatment 1, the plant which assigned treatment 1, here you may have a value. Here you may have Y11. It is the first block, first treatment, first block. Therefore, here you may have the value Y11. Therefore, here you may denote this as YIJ. Here, I denotes for the treatment and J denotes for the block. Always the first number stands for the treatment and second number stands for the block. Therefore, if you consider about this one, then here what is this? It is third treatment in the first block. Therefore, third treatment in the first block. Now you are writing it here, Y31. This is, in here you may get the value for second treatment in the first block. Therefore, now you can assign the value here as second treatment in the first block. Likewise, if you write all these values, then you will get first treatment in the second block. Here, second treatment in the second block. Here, third treatment in the second block. Therefore, likewise, you may get a table. Therefore, this is how you are getting this table in an ordered manner. Therefore, this is the initial table that you are getting, and here you can identify the block totals if you need, and block means you can identify. Therefore, if you consider about this in the row wise, since you have considered the blocks in the vertical way and treatments in the horizontal way, treatment numbering in the horizontal way and block numbering in the vertical way, then the row totals gives you the block total. It is because this is for the first block and this is for the second block. And when you are learning about the complete randomized design, you have learned about a notation called TI dot. TI dot means I treatment total. But here what you are getting is the first block total. Therefore, for the jth block, you are getting the total. Therefore, you can say this as the T dot J. Therefore, for the block total, you can say it as T dot J. This is how, therefore, you are getting the, you are using the notations to denote the totals. Therefore, for the bth block, you are having the total as T dot B. T dot B, it is because first letter stands for the treatment and second letter stands for the block number. Therefore, for the block B, you are getting its total. Therefore, for the block means you are having Y1 dot bar, Y2 dot bar. Likewise, here you are getting this Y dot B bar. This is for the block totals. And for the next one, as the next part, you have to get the treatment total. Therefore, since you have numbered the treatments in the horizontal manner, therefore, the first column, you are having the values for the first treatment. Therefore, Since this the first letter stands for the treatment, you can have the treatment total as the T1 dot. It means the first treatment total. Then T2 dot is the second treatment total. Likewise, if you are having k number of treatments, then treatment total can be obtained as the TK dot. And same as previous, we are using the T double dot for the grand total. Likewise, Y bar double dot for the grand mean. For the treatments also, you can obtain a mean. Therefore, mean treatment value can be obtained as Y1 dot bar, Y2 dot bar, up to YK dot bar, likewise. Therefore, this is how we are using the notations in the randomized complete block design. And now we will discuss about the statistical model for RCBD. When we are considering this previous part, what we had was, you had this Yij was there, and then what you had was mu was there, and tau I was there, and this epsilon Ij was there. In the previous one, you had just this treatment effect only. But once you come to this this randomized complete block design, there is an additional term called this block effect. Therefore, here you are having the statistical model as Yij equals mu plus tau I plus beta j plus epsilon ij. Since you are having k number of treatments, I is going from 1 to k. Since you are having b number of blocks, the j value goes from 1 to b. It is because I told you that the notation Yij is using here. I stands for the treatment and j stands for the block. Therefore, if you go through these names for the terms, then Yij is the random variable denoting the ijth observation. It is the observation in the ith treatment and the jth block. Rather than saying as the ijth observation, you can say it as the ith treatment, observation in the ith treatment and jth block. Mu stands for the overall mean. Tau I is the effect due to the ith treatment. Beta j, here it should be correct as not the tau j. This should be correct as beta j. Please correct this in your lecture note also. Beta j is the effect due to the jth block, and epsilon ij is the random error. And in the last session also, we have discussed about this term mu I equals mu plus tau I. It is the mu I is the ith treatment mean. Therefore, now we are defining additional expression as the mu j. Mu j is the jth block mean. Therefore, jth block mean can be identified using mu plus beta j. But actually, we are using these two equations as the using to identify the value for tau I and beta j. Therefore, the equation for tau I would be mu I minus mu means the I treatment mean minus the grand mean. Then to identify the jth block effect, you can use this mu j. It is the jth block mean minus the grand mean gives you the jth block effect. Therefore, these are the two equations. Actually, these are the two equations which will be helpful for our calculation to identify the treatment effect, estimations for treatment effect, and estimation for the block effect. And now we will go for the assumptions in the assumptions that we have to consider under randomized complete block design. Here, we are having k into b number of observation. It's like this. We are having totally n number of observation. This is coming under, we have a k number of treatments and b number of blocks. Therefore, k times b gives you this total number of observation. Therefore, this k times b observation constitute independent random samples. They are independent and each of size one. Therefore, if you consider a single plot or single square within a block, within a treatment, you are having only one value. And then from KB populations with unknown means mu ij. If you consider the ith treatment jth block, therefore the mean would be ij. Therefore we are considering actually this mean. That is why we are taking a single value for a jth block and ith treatment. We are having only one value. Then each KB population is normally distributed. Therefore, simply we can say the data are normally distributed, and then KB population has the same variance. All these has the same variance, and we are assuming that as the sigma square. And then the next important thing is block and treatment effects are additive. It means that if we are identifying this model, now you can see that in our model, treatments and blocks were just the additive model. This is an additive model. There is no any multiplicative terms. It means that there is no any interaction between blocks and the treatment. It is because you cannot identify any term called this tau times beta ij. Therefore, here we are assuming that tau times beta ij is equal to zero. It is because we are assuming that there is no interaction between the blocks and the treatment. That is why we are saying blocks and treatment effects are in the additive manner, and there is no interaction between the blocks and the treatments. These are the major assumptions that we have to follow when we are using this randomized complete block design. It is because if there is existence of the interaction, then you cannot apply this randomized complete block design. In such a situation, we have to go for an alternative design rather than using this RCBD. Now we will see about the hypothesis for randomized complete block design. When we see about the previous example, in the previous example, what we need to identify was there is any effect from the vitamins. Therefore, here also what we are going to test is under H naught, we are saying that all the K population means are equal versus at least one treatment mean is differ from other. Actually, this should be treatment mean. At least one treatment mean is differ from others. This is one way that you can write the hypothesis. Or else you can say that first treatment equals second treatment effect equals K treatment effects are equal to zero. It means that in other words, you can say that there is no treatment effect versus alternative would be tau I does not equals to tau j for some I and j. At least two treatment effects are different. It means that differ from zero. This is how you are writing the hypothesis. This is how we are writing the hypothesis for RCBD. In here, you can see that we are not going to construct any hypothesis for checking the blocking effect. But at the end, we are testing whether we need the blocking or not. Therefore, there is a method called finding the relative efficiency. But therefore, we are not going to test the hypothesis for blockings. Therefore, this is how you can identify the values. Therefore, for the hypothesis testing, we are used to test for the treatment means or the treatment effects. And to test this hypothesis, again, we are used the method called the analysis of variance, or we can abbreviate it as the ANOVA. Now, if you see about this ANOVA table, now source of variation, in the previous one, you had treatment error and total only, but here, since you have included the extraneous variable as the blocking, now your source of variation would be treatment, block, error, and the total. And then you have to identify the degrees of freedom for each of these variables. So since you had k number of treatments, k minus 1 would be the degrees of freedom for treatment. Since you had b number of blocks, B minus 1 would be the degrees of freedom for block. And for the error, you can take the value as multiplication of these two, or else you can use it as the previous one. In the previous method, what we had done was SST. From SST, you have to subtract these two. Therefore, you can identify SSE, degrees of SSE by the SST minus SSTR minus SS block. Therefore, this is how you are identifying the sum of squares. Therefore, you can use the same for the degrees of freedom. Therefore, here what we had for the SSE, we need to find it. For the SST, you are having n minus 1 degrees of freedom, but here n stands for the n coming from the k number of treatments into b number of blocks. Therefore, kb minus 1 would be the total degree of freedom. Here you are getting kb minus 1. Then for the degrees of freedom for treatment, you had k minus 1, and degrees of freedom for blocks would be b minus 1. Therefore, once you solve this equation, kb minus 1 minus k minus 1 minus b minus 1 gives you this expression k minus 1. Once you solve it, you can do it as a homework and try to obtain this equation. Therefore, once you solve this, you can end up with this calculation as the k minus 1 into b minus 1. This is the degrees of freedom for error. Now, to identify the sum of squares, but one other thing, you do not need to memorize all these equations, but if you know the method of identifying the error degrees of freedom, it would be totally enough. It is how to get the error degree of freedom is you have to subtract the addition of these two by the total degree of freedom. And if you see about sum of squares, these are the notations we are using. SSTR for the sum of treatment, sum of squares. Here SS block is the block sum of squares. Here SSE for the error sum of squares. SST is the total sum of squares. And then in the next column, you have to obtain the mean square value. To obtain the mean square, what you have to do is you have to divide the sum of square value with its degrees of freedom. Therefore, mean square for treatment can be obtained as the treatment sum of squares divided by k minus 1. Mean square for blocks can be obtained using the block sum of squares divided by b minus 1, its degree of freedom. Mean square error can be obtained as the error sum of squares divided by k minus 1 into b minus 1, which is the degrees of freedom for error. As the previous, here also you can calculate the F ratio by taking the ratio between treatment and error for the F value for treatment. For the block, also you can take the F value or the F ratio. It is obtained using the MS block, which is the mean square of block has to be divided by the mean square error. Therefore, this is how you are creating the ANOVA table. Therefore, this is the form of the ANOVA table. When you are providing the answers also, please do not try to interchange the columns. You can refer this forward, but if it is interchanged, it is okay. But the thing is, you have to, this way would be clear, easy for you, since this is like a pattern. And now we will see about what are the useful formulas of calculating these values. Here it is okay. For the F ratio, you are having complete formulas. For the mean square, you are having, if you know about these values, you can use these formulas directly. For the degrees of freedom, you are having complete formulas. But for the sum of squares, we need to identify the formulas of obtaining these values. To obtain these values for these quantities, we can use the following formula. Therefore, the useful formulas for RCBD. Here we are using total number of observation. N is the total number of observation. Therefore, N can be obtained by the K into B, number of treatments into number of blocks. And here also we are identifying a term called correction factor attributed by CEF. Here also correction factor is obtained by the grand total, squared term of the grand total divided by the total number of observations. Therefore, you have to add all the values, this t double dot, and then you have to square it, and then you have to divide it by n, or it can be divided by k times b, since k times b stands for the n, it is the total number of observations. Okay, now we are going to identify the treatment sum of squares. Here, when you are going to identify the treatment sum of squares, what you have to do is, first of all, you can take the treatment sums. First of all, you can take the treatment sum. Therefore, here you are getting t1 dot, t2 dot, likewise up to, you are getting up to tk dot. These are the treatment sums. Therefore, you have to square them. You have to square them, and then you have to take their summation. You have to take their summation. Therefore, since there are k number of treatments, if you are considering the I as the letter, therefore I goes from 1 to k, since there are k number of treatments and you are considering it as k I dot squared, since you have considered the squared. And this has to be divided by the number of blocks. It is because if you see about this data layout, once we go for the data layout, to identify the first treatment total, how many values you have used? You have used 1, 2, 3 up to B values. It is because this is how you are obtaining this treatment total. Therefore, for the first treatment, you are taking the summation of these B number of values. Therefore, you see the number of blocks will be B, and if you count the number of the values in the first treatment, 1, 2, 3 up to B values you had in the first treatment. Therefore, you can memorize in that way also if you need, or else you can just memorize the formula for the calculation. Therefore, if you see about the calculation, this is how you have to first take the treatment totals, then you square them, then take their summations, and then divide by the number of blocks. And then from this total number, then you have to subtract this correction factor. This is how you are getting the treatment sum of squares. This is how you are getting the treatment sum of squares. Now we will see how we can get the block sum of squares. In the block sum of squares, what we had was, in the first row, we had the value as, here it is the t dot 1, it is the first block total, here it is the second block total, likewise we had up to the b block total. Therefore we had the b number of blocks, and therefore we are having b number of totals. And thereafter getting the totals, what we can get is their squared terms, since they are getting their squared value. And then what we have to do is, we have to take the summation. Here we are using the notation for blocking totals. We can take this as the first, we have obtained the jth block total, and then we have squared it. And since we had b number of blocks, j is going from 1 to b. And to identify this block total, you had the k number of treatments. Therefore, you have to divide this by the number of treatments, and then to identify the block sum of squares, here also you have to subtract the correction factor. Therefore, using this equation, you can obtain the block sum of squares. And then to obtain the error sum of squares, you can directly use this expression. Means that error sum of squares equals to total sum of squares minus treatment sum of squares minus block sum of squares. Therefore, by subtracting the treatment sum of squares and block sum of squares from the total sum of square, you can obtain the value for error sum of squares. And to identify the error sum of squares, now you have identified the value for this SSTR and SSBR. But before obtaining the value for error sum of squares, we need to identify this total sum of squares. Then what you can do is, to obtain the total sum of squares, you can use the same method as previous. Here also, here we are getting the square term of each observation, square term of each observation, and then take the summation of all of them. That is what I mentioned as the, you have to consider this k number of treatment, I is going from 1 to k, as well as you have to consider the b number of blocks, j is also going from 1 to b, and you have to consider the square term of all these observations. Therefore, it is the square term of yij, and you have to get their summation, and then at the end, you have to subtract the correction factor to obtain this SS key value. Therefore, these are the useful formula to identify the values for the ANOVA table. After getting the values for ANOVA table, again you can use this F table to identify the critical value. Therefore, if you consider for the treatments, the F table value you can obtain as the critical value for treatment, it can be obtained as F. Degrees of freedom for numerator would be k-1, because the degrees of freedoms in the treatment, and then here degrees of freedom in the denominator would be degrees of freedom in the error, it goes k-1 into b-1, and then we are considering the level as alpha. Normally we are considering alpha as 0.05. at the level of 5% significance, we are considering we are testing for the hypothesis. Therefore, you can consider the value of alpha would be equal to 0.05. therefore, this is how we are getting the critical value. This is how we are getting the critical value using the F table. Okay, now we will go for an example for this RCBD. Therefore, if you see about this example, in this example, an experiment was run to determine whether the concentration level of vitamin effect on the height of the tomato varieties. And that experimental data has included in the following table. Sometimes you are getting the data and you may ask to identify what is the treatment and what would you consider as the block. Here what you need to do is, you need to identify whether there is any effect from concentration level of vitamin towards the height of tomato varieties. Therefore, you are observing the height of this tomato variety and you need to test whether there is any effect from this concentration level of vitamins. Therefore, you just have the 5 tomato varieties. Therefore, since variety is not that much, we are not having a concern on the variety, therefore we can consider that as, we can consider it as the extraneous variable. Therefore, the extraneous variable can be considered for the blocking. Therefore, there were 5 tomato varieties, and then there were 4 treatment levels used for the experiment. Therefore, for this first block, we have applied all the 4 treatments. In the second block, all the 4 treatments were applied. In the 5th block also, we have applied all the treatments, and the height of the tomato varieties of these plants were measured, and they have included in this table. And in this example also, they are asking first to construct the ANOVA table and write down the relevant hypotheses and test the hypotheses, and they are asked to write down the conclusion, and then write down the estimates for overall mean and the treatment effects. Okay, now we will see how we can do this. Therefore, first of all, you are asked to construct the annotable. Therefore, when you are getting the annotable, first of all, I have identified my treatments and my blocks. Treatments are the concentration level of the vitamin, and the block is the plant variety. And we are saying that the mu ij is the ijth population mean, and the fourth of the treatment I and block j. And now we will see about this treatment and concentration levels. This is the initial table. This part is the initial table that we had. This part is the initial table that we had for our example. And now we will identify this total. Therefore, here I am having the block totals. Therefore, T dot J denotes to show the block totals. Block totals, and their square terms are denoted by the T dot J square. Forget about this, the last column, for a while. You can do it in the horizontal way or the vertical way, no problem. I have used it as the last column here. It is used for the calculation of SST. Therefore, so far we will discuss about these first two. Therefore, here you are having the block totals, and here you are having the square term for block total. Therefore, if you add the first four values, you got the 58.8. Then for the second block total, you have to add these four values, then you end up with the value as 70. Likewise, for the fifth block, you have to add these four values, and then you have obtained the value as 73.4. And here you can see that I have used the notation as TI dot. TI dot is for the treatment total. Treatment total. Since these are the treatment total, in the column manner, I have to get the summations. Therefore, if I consider the first column, then first column total is equal to 61.8. Then for the second column, it's the second treatment. Therefore, if you add all these five values, you got 100. Here, likewise, for the fourth treatment, you have to add these five values to get the value as 73.9. Therefore, now you have obtained the treatment totals. Therefore, in the next row, you can square these values. Square 61.8, then you will get this value. Then square term of 100 gives you this 10,000. Therefore, likewise, you can obtain the squared values of their treatment totals, square terms for treatment total. And you can get the value for T double dot, or it is for the grand total. To obtain the value for grand total, what you can do is you can take the addition of these values, or else you can take the addition of these values. In what way? In the vertical way or the horizontal way, you can do the calculation. Both ways you have to get the same answer. Therefore, if you add these five values, you got 354, or else if you add these four values again, you must get this 354. Therefore, you can use this value to check whether the calculation is correct or not. Therefore, if you are getting two different values from the vertical addition and the horizontal addition, then it says that some values may be wrong, or is one value, or maybe some values may be wrong. Therefore, this is how you are getting the treatment total. Here you are getting the treatment total as 355. I told about the last column. This last column is the summation of the squared term, summation of the squared term of this observation. Therefore, if I get the sum squared term of 9.1, and then it add to the squared term of 17.1, then add this to the squared term of 20.8, and add this to the squared term of 11.8. Therefore, this gives you the value as 947.10. Then square these values, and then you can get the total as 1648.54. Likewise, you can get this y I j squared terms. Actually, this should be here. You are getting this for the summation of j goes, sorry, summation of I goes from 1 to 4. You had the value. Here you are getting the y I, and for the j equals 1, you are getting this value. Here you are getting this for the, you are having 4 treatments. I goes from 1 to 4. It is for the I, and this is for the second block. Likewise, you can get the value. First block, second block, likewise up to the fifth block, you can get value. Here you are getting summation. I goes from 1 to 4. And this is for the y I, and here this is the fifth block, and you have to consider its squared term. Therefore, without worrying about this notation, you can just have the squared term of the observation and then add it. And as the last part, you have to get the summation of all these values. Therefore, the summation of all these values gives you the summation of I goes from 1 to k, and j goes from 1 to b, and here you are getting this as the y I j squared terms. Therefore, the addition of all these values gives you the quantity for this. Therefore, it would be easy for the calculation if you are doing the calculation in the same table, or else you can do it in a separate manner. After finishing of obtaining of these values, then you can directly go for the calculation. Therefore, if you go for the calculation, now you can see, first of all, we have to identify the correction factor. Correction factor can be obtained using the t double dot square divided by k times b. Here we have to identify that another two terms. Value of k is equal to number of treatment is 4. Value of b is equal to 5. It is the number of blocks equal to 5. Therefore, you can use this equation. You can add all these values. We had 20 values. Therefore, you can add all the values and get its squared terms. Or else you can simply get, since you have obtained the addition for all these values, you can get the addition of this as the t double dot as 355 squared. Then divide by 4 times 5, it is 20. Therefore, you got the correction factor as 6301.25. Then we have to identify the SST value. SST is the total sum of square value. Then total sum of square, you have to get the summation of I goes from 1 to k and j goes from 1 to b for y I j squared. And then you have to subtract correction factor from it. Therefore, what you can do is, you have to square each value and then you have to get their summation, or else you can simply get the summation of this column. Therefore, this value gives you the addition of these values, gives you the value as 6810.28. Then subtract the correction factor. This is the squared term of summation of the squared term of observation minus the correction factor. Then SST is 509.03. Then you can use the equation to find out the treatment. Treatment sum of squares can be obtained using Ti dot squared divided by B. It is because it is, and now you have identified the treatment totals and their squared terms. Therefore, here you are having 3819.24, then 14232.49, 5461.21. You have to add these values and then you have to divide it by 5. It is because you had the 5 blocks. Then you can get the value as 6710.2.588. Then you have to subtract the correction factor from it. Therefore, you are getting the treatment sum of squares as the 401.338. If you consider for the blockings, blocking sum of squares, you can get it as the t dot ये स्क्वायर मींस द ब्लॉक टोटल स्क्वायर डिवाइडेड बाय के नंबर ऑफ ट्रीटमेंट. देयरफॉर हियर यू आर हैविंग द स्क्वायर टर्म्स फॉर ब्लॉकिंग साम्स एंड देन यू हैड द फोर ट्रीटमेंट. देयरफॉर द समेशन हैज टू बी डिवाइडेड बाय हियर यू हैड फाइव ब्लॉक्स एंड there is a mistake here. This value should be equal to 4. Okay, if I check the calculation again, then here dividing this by 4 gives you the value as 6382.775. Just a typing mistake here, therefore you can correct it as 4. Then 6382.775 minus the correction factor gives you the SS block sum of squares as 81.525. Okay, now what we have to do is we have to identify the error sum of squares, because now for total finish, treatment finish, block is finished. Now you have to identify the error sum of squares. To identify the value for error sum of squares, you can use this equation. Error sum of squares equal to total sum of squares minus treatment sum of squares minus block sum of squares. Therefore, once you substitute the values there, you can obtain the error sum of squares as the 26.167. Therefore, this is how you obtain the error sum of squares. And now we can use this ANOVA table for this hypothesis testing. First of all, you are asked to obtain the ANOVA table. Therefore, your source of variation was treatment, block error and total, and degrees of freedom. You can obtain this by, for the treatment, you obtain by K minus K equals, there were 4 treatments and there were 5 blocks. Therefore, the degrees of freedom for treatment is 3. Degrees of freedom for block given by B minus 1. 5 minus 1 gives you the value as 4. Then we will find the value for total first. It is KB minus 1. K times B is 4 times 5 is 20. Minus 1 gives you the value as 19. Then what you can do is you can subtract this 3 and 4 by this 19 to obtain the error degrees of freedom. Therefore, you can do it as 19 minus 3 minus 4. Then you are ending up with the value as 12. It is the error degrees of freedom. This is the error degrees of freedom. Now you have already identified the sum of squares for these. Therefore, you can directly write the values that you have obtained. Therefore, when you are writing the values, please check again whether you are writing the appropriate value in the appropriate cell. Therefore, sometimes the students are taking these values correctly, but when they are asked to write it in the cells, then they are not writing it properly. Therefore, what you can do is you can double check once you are writing the values. Therefore, for the treatment, the values that you have obtained, here it was 81.5. Yes. Here actually these two should be changed. Here also the same mistake done by my side. Therefore, here also we have to make it for the treatment, we will get 401.338, and for the blocks we are getting 81.525. Therefore, I will correct this in the lecture note and upload the new note for the VLE. Therefore, you can refer the new note. And for the error, it is okay. For the total, same value. Therefore, if you consider about the treatment MS was 7793, and this value should be for the MS for the blocks should be 20.3813, and if you consider about the F ratios here also, you have to consider about this mean square divided mean square for treatment divided by mean square error. Then here you are getting this as 61.35, and for the blockings it is 9.35. Therefore, when we are writing the values, you have to pay our attention. This because here also we have done the same mistake. Therefore, I will correct this in the lecture note also. But for now, you can just cut these values and write down the correct values. Therefore, this is the ANOVA table obtained. And now what we have to do is they are asking the testing for the hypothesis. In the testing for writing the hypothesis, what we can get is here we are having treatments. Since we are having four treatments, then we can say four treatments are equal versus at least one treatment mean is differ from others. At least one treatment mean is differ from others. And then here you can say rather than we had this finite number, therefore we are having, or else we can say it is tau 1 equals, tau 2 equals, tau 3 equals, tau 4 equals 0 versus at least one tau I does not equals for some I and j. Once you are writing I and j, you can say that I goes from 1 to 4 and j goes from 1 to 5. Here we are writing what are the levels of I and j. And then the calculated F value, here the calculated F value, we had changed it. For the treatment, we had the value was 61.35. Then we have to compare it with the critical value. In the critical value, for the treatment, we had the degrees of freedom as 3. For the error, we had the degrees of freedom as 12. Therefore, you have to check the F table for this value, F3, 12 for the alpha level 0.05. Therefore, once you check the F table, you will get the value as 3.4903. And if you see about the table, now you can see the table below. Yeah, you have included the F table here. It is for the 3, means the numerator degrees of freedom is 3, and denominator degrees of freedom is 12. Therefore, once you see about the value, value is 3.4903. Therefore, you have to use this value to check with the calculated value. Therefore, since the critical value is equal to 3.49, then and the calculated value is somewhat more away from this, it was around 61.35. Calculated value was 61.35. Therefore, if you see about the F table, then the F distribution, use your graph in this way, skewed distribution. And you may have the critical value somewhat here, it is 3.4903. And this would be the rejection region. This would be the rejection region. Therefore, if the value falls into this region, then definitely we have to reject the null hypothesis. Therefore, what we can do is see about where is the calculated value situated. Falls in here, it is somewhat here, 61.35 is the calculated value. Therefore, you can say that since the calculated value is greater than the critical value, then we have to reject the H naught. H naught is rejected under 5% significance level. Therefore, it can be concluded that there is a significant effect from the concentration level of vitamin, and it affects on the height of the tomato varieties at 5% significance level. Therefore, this is how you are writing the conclusion. And you can say, or else we can say that there is a treatment effect. It is because we are rejecting the null hypothesis. It is that treatment means are equal to zero versus treatment means are not equal to zero. Therefore, if you are using the second one, you can say it as the addition is not changing. H naught is anyhow rejecting. But when you are interpreting it, you have to do it in an appropriate manner. And the last part of this is finding the treatment effects. Here also, here we have get the overall mean. To get the overall mean, what you have to do is you have to divide this overall mean is by double dot bar. Can be obtained using T double dot divided by K times B. T double dot, the value was 355, and then you have to divide it by 4 times 5, value is 20. Then you can get the answer for the overall mean as 17.75. Then treatment effect can be obtained using this equation. These are the estimated values. Therefore, to obtain the estimated values, you can use the sample means. Therefore, you can say it as the rho i hat as the estimated value. This can be obtained using the xi bar. It is the i treatment means minus the grand mean. Therefore, if you consider the i treatment mean, i treatment total divided by the number of observations used, therefore you can get the estimated treatment effects for the 4 treatments as minus 5.39, 2.25, 6.11, and minus 1.89. Therefore, these are the estimated treatment effect for this experiment. But when we are discussing about this experiment, when we are defining this experiment, what we had done was, at the very beginning I told you that sometimes unnecessarily we are using this blocking. Therefore, actually we need to test whether the blocking is necessary or not. To check whether the blocking is necessary or not, we can use this concept called the estimated relative efficiency. Therefore, sometimes we are unnecessarily using the blockings for some experiment. Therefore, for the investigation of the effectiveness of blocking, we can estimate the relative efficiency, and we can denote it by the RE for the randomized complete block design. And now think about, if the relative efficiency is less than the threshold value, then we can say that blocking is not necessary. Therefore, we can go for the CRD rather than using a complex design as the randomized complete block design. Therefore, to identify the estimated value for the relative efficiency, you can use this equation. Relative efficiency can be obtained by C plus 1 minus C times mean square of blocking divided by the mean square error. And the value of C can be obtained using the B times K minus 1 divided by the BK minus 1. But when we are doing the calculations, we can show that if this relative efficiency is greater than 1, then without considering about this, the terms associated with C, we can just make an inequality using the latter term. It is MS block divided by MSE. Therefore, when we are going for the calculation of relative efficiency, to identify the value for relative efficiency, we have to definitely use this equation. But if it is just to identify whether the blocking is necessary or not, you can just use this term only, MS block divided by MSE, to identify whether the blocking is needed or not. If you are asked to calculate the relative efficiency, definitely you have to use the equation. Just to identify whether the blocking is necessary or not, it is enough to use this latter part of the equation. Therefore, we can show that using a calculation, if the relative efficiency from this is greater than 1, then definitely MS block divided by MSE greater than 1. For the relative efficiency, if the relative efficiency less than 1, then MS block divided by MSE also less than 1. If these are equal to 0, then MS block divided by MSE is again equal to 1. Therefore, based on the value that we are obtained for the relative efficiency, we can conclude whether the the blocking is necessary or not for the given experiment. Therefore, the threshold values are defined like this. If the relative efficiency is greater than 1, then we can say that blocking is necessary. If the relative efficiency is less than 1, then we can say that blocking is not necessary. But if we are getting relative efficiency equals to 1, we can say that blocking is neither helped or nor hurt. Therefore, we can use the blocking, or else we can omit the blocking if we are getting relative efficiency equals to 1. But if you are getting relative efficiency less than 1, they are definitely saying that blocking is not necessary. Therefore, if the blocking is not necessary, then we can go for a simplest design as the complete randomized design. Therefore, if the blocking is not necessary, then we can again match this with the CRD method. Therefore, the next thing is, when we are designing an experiment, always we have to use the most simplest appropriate and the most simplest block. Sometimes the given experiment can apply several designs, but we have to identify always the simplest method that we can apply for it. Therefore, if the blocking is not necessary, there is no point of using RCBD. Therefore, in such a situation, we can use the complete randomized design. Therefore, if you see about the previous example, if you ask to calculate the relative efficiency, then you can get the relative efficiency by using this value. Here also I have to check whether the values are correct. Yeah, I have used the correct value for the MS block. This calculation is okay. Therefore, to calculate the relative efficiency, C is, you can calculate the value of C in this way. 5 times 4 minus 1, 3, then 20 minus 1, 90. Therefore, value of C would be 0.7895. And using this value, relative efficiency can be obtained as the 2.75. Since this value is greater than 1, then we can say that blocking is necessary for the experiment. Therefore, RCBD would be an appropriate method. But in here, they are asking just to check whether the blocking is necessary. They are not asking the calculate value for relative efficiency. Therefore, since this calculation is not us, then we can omit this calculation and we can just use this MS block and MSE to identify whether the blocking is necessary. Therefore, in this situation, rather than going for this calculation, we can simply say MS block equal the value of MS block and the value of MSE, then if you take this ratio, you can definitely see that this ratio is around, nearly it is around 10. Therefore, definitely this value, since the numerator is greater than the denominator, definitely you must get a value which is greater than 1. Therefore, you can say that definitely relative efficiency is greater than 1. It is because you had identified an equation. If the relative efficiency is, if and only if this both way it is correct. If the relative efficiency is greater than 1, then this ratio is greater than 1. Or else in the other way around also it is correct. If this ratio is greater than 1, then the relative efficiency is always also greater than 1. Therefore, using that concept, we can say that now the relative efficiency is greater than 1. Therefore, we can conclude that the blocking is necessary for the experiment. Therefore, this is how you are checking that whether the blocking is necessary for the experiment. And this is an experiment for you. You can do this as a homework. And here they have identified 7 regions, and this treatment is the cold seam. And they have identified it from these 7 geographical regions. And you can use this, you can do these questions as the homework, and as first you have to construct the ANOVA table, and then you have to write down the appropriate hypotheses and test them, and you have to write down the conclusion, and then you have to write down the estimates for overall mean and the treatment effects. Then you can, for this experiment, you can again identify whether actually the blocking is necessary or not. Therefore, you can do it as an exercise, and this is all for the randomized complete block design. And thank you.